and darkling with evil eyes for lamb, with evil eyes for lambs. And fatal voices chanting from the apse. Fatal voices chanting from the apse. So in the church, you have got that big long corridor at the end of the apse. Behind the altar, the apse. And around that thing, the ambulator, you go around and move around, you see. So Samuel has given complete church description here. In darkling aisles. So you have got first darkling aisle, then you have got the altar. Behind that is the apse. Behind that is, around that is the, all those things are there. In strange, infernal, dim basilica, intoning the magic of the holy word. So in that church, what they do? Magic of the unholy word, not a divine word, an holy word. So that is the complete church image, which is also realistic in a certain sense, as you see. Intoning the magic of the unholy word. The Om is profound, initiate, profound, initiate, profound ritual of her mystery of that night of the word, unholy word. Initiate her mystery. Complete description, full description. In darkling hands with evil eyes or lamps. So we got lamps there, with candle. Well, actually, normally candles or lamps, now see. And fatal was a chanting from apse. In strange, infernal basilica, intoning magic. Because he has seen all that. He lived for 11 years. He was with the priest and he knows everything about Christianity, you see. His rituals and all that thing. Nobody else could have written like that, you see. You know that. Their suffering was nature's daily food. Well, you live because of you suffer. Alluring to the anguished heart and pleasure, and torture, the formula, torture for the formula of delight, pain mimicked the celestial ecstasy. Pain mimicked the celestial ecstasy. People are there who enjoy somebody's suffering. You beat, you kill, you do all kind of things, torture them. People enjoy that kind of thing. It's absolutely bestial, in fact, worse than bestial, you see. It is demonic, devilish, you see. They are suffering for nature's daily food, alluring to the anguished heart and pleasure, and torture with the formula of delight. Pain mimicked the celestial ecstasy. There, good, if faith is guarder of God. So, the good has become now the fall, you see, he's giving the fall. Good has become the faithless gardener of God. Watered with virtue, the world's upas tree. Watered with virtue, the world's upas tree. The poison tree of Java. Upas tree. Upas tree. Now, actually, it is a tall, huge tree, and it is said that around 16 miles of that tree, nothing can live. It exudes poison, and that poison will kill every kind of life. Nothing will exist around that tree. 16 miles around that tree, nothing will exist. Upas tree in Java, you see. Nothing will exist here. Upas tree, huh?
No, it's not true.
Does it exist now?
No, it's not true, no.
Well,
16 miles
is not possible. Another road.
Pardon me? No. In another road.
No, it is true. See, now, it is true. That there is a tree like that.
Where?
And around that tree, there is no life at all for 16 miles around it.
Where?
In Java.
Java?
Huh. In Java. Java. I got the... Batar, they call it Batar, Java Batar. Now,
so what is it, food or seed or wheat? What is
it? I'll come to that. But here the description is of a tree which will not allow anything to exist around it.
Yeah.
Metaphorically, the tree will not allow anything to live around it in that area completely, you see. Metaphorically, that is how you see here. Now, It is a fact in Java, butter. Now, people had done some sort of an investigation, scientific research, and there is a paper in Scientific America published more than 150 years ago, 1858, about this particular tree. And they say that it is true that that tree exists there and there is no life around it, but that there is no life around it is not due to the tree, but due to kind of a poisonous eruption of volcano which was present there.
Oh, okay.
Poisonous gases which are coming out at one time of time. It is that poisonous gas which is not allowing any life to exist at all. It is not due to the tree.
But this tree could
exist. It exists.
Now, even the volcano.
Yes, yes, it exists. Exactly.
So, it's very powerful.
Yeah, it's very powerful, very strong tree. Yeah, it exists, you see. It's a very strong, powerful tree, you see. Upas tree. This is it's a famous kind of a tree. And nothing around that thing exists because of this poisonous fumes which are coming from that volcano which is burst at one time, you see. No life is present there at all. Scientific American has a big article on that, published more than 1858, I think. Yeah, 1858, July 1858, published in long ago, you see. Yeah. Now, of course, here it is used as a metaphor in the sense that this tree, the poison tree, will not allow any life to grow around it at all, completely, completely. Now, obviously, world superstream. So, it is not just around 16 miles. This metaphor is so strong that around that whole thing, no life will be possible at all, completely, you see. It's a very powerful metaphor in that sense, you see. Now, these people had done further investigation. They say that the tree does not emit any poisonous gas, exhume any poisonous gas at all, the tree. But the juice of that tree is extremely poisonous. The juice of that tree is extremely poisonous, completely, you see. But the tree by itself does not exhume. So that is the scientific finding. The tree is there, it's a very poisonous tree. And it seems that tree also occurs in other parts of the world, in South Africa or somewhere there around that thing kind of a thing. And its juice is extremely poisonous. Poisonous, so people what they do is, they extract that poison, that juice, make it dry and put it on the arrow tips. Arrow tip. So when you are shooting with that arrow, any animal or any person is bound to die immediately. So they are exploiting that juice also for the purposes of fighting against things like that, you see. They did like that, you see. So this is the kind of a scientific background of the tree, Upas tree. But the fact is that around it, metaphorically, no life can exist. It is not a tree which is causing the absence of life there, because the tree is not exhuming any poison gas. The poison gas is coming because of the eruption from the volcano. But at the same time, the tree has a very, very, very poisonous juice in it, you see. Upas tree, watered with virtue. So you are growing, nourishing the tree with virtue. The world is Upas tree, poison tree, you see, poison tree. And careful with the outward word and act, engrafted his hypocrite blooms on native soil. His God, gardener of God, engrafted his hypocrite blooms on native soil. So this is the fall, you see, describing now, fourth stage, you are describing good, how good has become an evil. Being was there first, then came bliss, then came thought. Now is the good, you see. All things high, so the neither opposite. So this is the complete fall. Those who have entered here, now they have become completely opposite, antagonistic. All things high, so that neither opposite. The forms of God sustained the demon called. The form, see, they were actually the emanations of God. But then they got so away from God Himself that they have become opposite, and they have built up their own cult, their own civilization, their own way of life and thinking. Heaven's face became a mask and snare of hell. So that is the fall. So he has described first being, then he has described bliss, then he has described thought, he has described good, now he is describing heaven. Heaven has become now hell, you see. Heaven has become, heaven which became a mark. So that is the separation, you see, the fall, the involution of prostitution. Now this theme of involution appears in number of places in Savitri, in different contexts. This is one particular context in which you could. We see some of them thing later on in more detail, but that's how it happens, you see. There, in the heart of vain phenomenon, in an enormous actions written code, he saw a shape illimitable and way. He, Ashwapati, in spite of this fall, after this involution, he still sees some kind of a meaning, some kind of a sense, significance, illimitable and vague. He saw a shape, there is a definite form there, sitting on death, who swallows all things above. So after the fall, what does he see? He sees a shape, illimitable and vague, sitting on death. She is sitting on death. Who is she? He saw a shape, illimitable. Who is that person? The mother of evil. She is the mother of evil. The mother of evil is sitting on death. Mother of evil sitting, mother of evil sitting. In other words, there in the heart of vain phenomenon, in an enormous actions, written core, he saw a shape illimitable way, sitting on death, who swallows all things born. Now, who is swallowing all things born?
Death.
It is on that death she is sitting, the mother of evil. So if you want evil to go away, the necessity is to knock off the death. She is sitting on death, and therefore if you want to remove the evil, you have to knock off death completely. So that is the entire argument. Evil will exist, falsehood will exist, as long as death is present. They are sitting on it. Evil is sitting on death. So you cannot remove evil unless you remove death. So the entire crux, the entire issue lies in handing death. That is in fact the problem, the proposition of Savitri. Savitri comes here to knock out death completely. When she does that, then evil and falsehood all will disappear. All will disappear. So the work of Savitri is connected with that. To knock out this death, yeah, on whom all these things are sitting. You see. A chill, fixed face with dire and motionless eye. A chill, fixed face with dire and motion. That is the description of that lady. Her, he says now, her dreadful stern in a shadowy hand, a chill fixed face with dire and motionless, she's sitting there, her dreadful. Now, this trident is wrong. It is trident. In the 1950 edition, it is a strident, but that is a printing mistake. It is actually trident, trident, 3.8 spear, Poseidon's trident, or Shiva's trident. Shiva has a trident with three prongs in his hand. And she is sitting, Durga, she has got a trident in her hand, one of the weapons in her hand is a trident. On that Shiva's Durga is there, trident in the shadowy hand. So she is, that mother of evil is carrying a trident. For what? You cannot deny me, disobey me. My trident is there. So if a good person comes and denies that thing, she is there to pierce it. Means the act of Durga is being performed by this lady in the nether world, this mother of evil. She is the deformed, degraded, fallen Durga. So if you want to call it now, starting from you had being, you had bliss, you have got thought, you have got good, you have got after good we had the hell, and then now good, hell, and now Durga, the fallen Durga is there, the mother of evil, you see, the descent. When she enters into this world, this is what happens to her: a chill, fixed face, with tired and motionless eyes. Motionless eyes, she is firm in her mind. Her dreadful trident in her shadowy hand outstretched, she pierced all creatures with one wave. That is her act. But now, this Durga, but remove all that opposes this thing, the divine Durga who comes every October to the ashram. She used to meet Mother Durga in every October on the Saturday, you see. She used to spend a lot of time there, and they had got a lot of conversation. Ajanta is full of that, you see. And very, very interesting kind of conversations are there. A chill, fixed face, with tired and motionless eyes, and dreadful trident in her shadowy hand, outstretched, she pierced all creatures with one pain. So this is the kind of introduction to the canto. You see, here described the entire fall, how it has happened here, and now the multiplicity of these forms which are there. It will follow this next section. When nothing was same, matter without soul. We'll take up that next time, you see. What a rich canto also.
Yes.
See, I mean, just 17 sentences, but see the kind of picture you have drawn. Such a detailed picture you will not get anywhere in the literature. No Puranas are going to describe you all that. It's with such precision. Because he's seeing them and writing them down simply forever. What a description.
So how will the supermind change?
Pardon me?
How will the supermind change?
See, it is a process of evolution. Mm-hmm. Now, first thing, you have absolute void. Out of that absolute void, in conscience is born. Out of that in conscience, form, matter entered. Matter became form. Then life entered. In other words, you have to prepare the ways by the entry of these higher powers for the supermind. If supermind comes directly, straight away, without matter and life and mind, the whole thing will get simply crushed. So these powers are really building up a base, a support for supramental action and supramental manifestation. So, it is a kind of a logical process that it has to go through this cycle. Physical, the vital, the mental, the spiritual, then the supramental. Unless that kind of a richness is produced here, that firmness, that base is adhara, is produced here, the supermind will not be able to. Otherwise, everything will get completely crushed, you see. The whole purpose is lost then, you see. The whole purpose. So, there is a great divine occult logic in the sequence of this evolution. It is not for nothing. We feel that it is a torture and pain and suffering because we are seeing only a small segment of the bigger trajectory. The trajectory is from nothing to full manifestation, but we are seeing only a small part of it, and therefore the small part we feel miserable, happy. It is due to ignorance of ours that we are not able to understand and grasp the meaning, the necessity, the purpose behind this entire operation. The divine logic is perfect, is impeccable, is meaningful with a certain kind of an operative detail at every stage. We had to therefore grow into that divine quality to understand the divine process. Otherwise we will curse him, what fellow he is making this kind of a world like that, you see. But this is the whole process by which you cannot help it. And then when he is doing that thing, you see, to us all these people, Pishachas, Rakshasas, Asuras, the demon, the Jain, the Titan, they appear terrible and they appear horrible, you see. But then if you see the content behind it, there is sort of a joy that something has come out. That life force was now present in a certain kind of a dynamic manner. Maybe it may not be very good. You have got dinosaurs, you have got this thing, you have got that kind of a thing. For a certain purpose, that itself is joy. So everywhere there is a divine bliss in the creation, even in that place. The divine is enjoying because out of nothing something has come out. Is that not a great thing? How is that not a great thing? Is not a thing to be enjoyed, to be happy about it, you see, that out of nothing something has come out. Maybe today it looks, but then out of that ugliness a flower starts opening out and blossoming. Is that not yet another beauty, another joy of coming? Like that it will keep on happening. So at any moment of this evolution, although to us in a limited manner looks ugly and very disgusting and very painful and all that thing, there is a sort of a joy in it, you see, that out of nothing, something is emerging constantly. What else can be both? You see, so the divine is enjoying in that sense, you see, something is happening. Nispa? You don't agree?
Yes, I agree.
You don't agree? You can't help it. It is there. It is so. And I really think it is a kind of a joy. To create even the absolute void is a joy. It is a joy of creation. You are bringing out something creative that is always an act of bliss, an act of joy.
Yeah, but if you're not, have to be in it and suffer.
If you don't understand your whole purpose, then gone. You see, because you are saying, you are scolding a child. You feel very happy, unhappy, and that kind of. But then you are doing for the good of the child that you don't remember. The child will see later on that, well, what I was getting was for my good. For my good. To give a certain discipline, certain way of life and that kind of a thing, you are imposing on him. So he may feel very miserable at that moment of time, but in the course of life, he will understand that it was good for my growth, for my progress, for my well-being.